In this video lecture, we want to introduce the Math class, which is a Java-provided class with standalone capabilities for all the standard math operations. Okay, let's get started. Whenever we have a need in our programs to do any standard mathematical calculations, we can draw upon the Java-provided Math class to do this. The Math class is part of the java.lang package, which means that it is always available to us and does not need to be explicitly imported. So in that regard, it's comparable to using the String class in our programs. The Math class provides two standard mathematical constants for the natural log e and for pi. It also provides a number of methods to perform many common math calculations. These lecture notes will give only an abridged version of what's in the Math class. For a full list of its capabilities, you'll need to explore its Java API, which we'll do soon in a companion lecture. One important thing to point out about the Math class is that all of its methods and constants are static. Remember that this means that such methods are called in the absence of any created objects. They are called using the name of the class instead, as we see here. And there's a good reason for this. When we're performing math operations, we don't necessarily want to have to create individual math objects to perform routine calculations. We want to simply compute a result and move on. So the static methods of the Math class give us this kind of standalone, object-independent capability. Also, many of the math methods are overloaded methods, which simply means there may be alternate forms accepting different input data types. So what this usually means for us is that these methods will accept any type of numerical input, up to and including doubles, because all numerical input types can be implicitly promoted up to doubles. We'll see this a bit later when we take a look at the Math API. For starters, we said that the Math class provides two static constants for pi and the natural log e. To access these constants, we use them statically by preceding them with the name of their containing class, as shown here. Here, Math is our static class, and we know these are constants because they observe the usual all caps naming convention. These two are nothing but freely available numerical constants. So if we were to print these constants out, these are the values which would be displayed. At this point, I'd like to refer you to the short code walkthrough video for mathexamples.java. This example file will contain useful examples of all the Math class constants and methods we'll be covering in this lecture video. I'll be referring to this example file frequently, so I would suggest that you download this file from the usual place and open it up in JGrasp so that you can follow along. You can also go back and forth to the accompanying code walkthrough video for more explanations. But do make sure to examine that source code file, because there are many useful examples in there. Here are a handful of the most commonly used methods of the Math class. We'll be using these in a current homework program assignment, so you'll want to know these ones. These are nothing but standard workhorse mathematical operations: absolute value, natural logarithm, base 10 logarithm, square root, and exponentiation. For the absolute value method abs, note that it will have several overloaded forms, which can accept multiple data type inputs: double, float, int, or long. Then, the data type of the result will be of the same type as the input. For these other three methods, note that they accept only double data type inputs and return a double data type result. This is okay though, because recall that double is the largest data type, and any numerical value or data type can be implicitly or explicitly cast up to a double with no loss of numerical precision. Besides, it doesn't really make sense to compute these in anything less than decimal precision anyway. Also, note that Java provides the pow method for raising a number to some power, because it doesn't provide any exponentiation operator like these, as do some other programming languages. Again, I will refer you to the mathexamples.java source code file, or its accompanying code walkthrough video, for good examples of using these methods. Next, here's the round method, used to round some decimal point number to its nearest whole number equivalent, subject to these usual mathematical conventions. Notice that here there are two forms of the method interface. If the input data type is a double, which will accommodate any floating point number, the resulting output data type is a long, since that will accommodate the largest possible integer values. But there is also an alternate form as noted. If the input data type is a float instead, then the resulting output data type is an int instead. Once again, I'll refer you to the mathexamples.java source code file or its accompanying code walkthrough video for examples of using this method. Finally, the math class provides min and max methods for determining the smaller or larger value of some input pair of numbers. Later on, of course, we could implement this for ourselves using some simple logic, but Java provides a simple method to do this. Again, notice that there are several overloaded versions of these methods, such that the data type of the result will be of the same data type as the inputs. So these methods can handle doubles, floats, ints, and longs. While it's very straightforward to use these methods to find the min or max of any two given numbers, more often than not, we need to find the min or max of some series of numbers. To do that using these min or max methods, we can proceed in two ways. The first way would be to proceed in stages. So let's say we find the smaller of the first two numbers, then we use that intermediate result to compare against the next number, as shown in this first example. Or we could do this in one operation using nesting, as shown in the second example. Here, this entire expression in blue is the same as this first step above, and it evaluates to one single value, which is then compared to the third value for a final result. This second approach can similarly be extended to four or more inputs, but practically speaking, it will quickly become needlessly complicated. More realistically, this first approach better lends itself to comparing to additional values. Or better yet, we could wrap some sort of loop around this and extend it to any arbitrary number of values, but more on that in a future lecture. Once again, I'll refer you to the mathexamples.java source code file or its accompanying code walkthrough video for code examples of both these approaches. Okay, that's it for now in the math class. Between the methods we've presented here and the examples in the source code file, you should have what you need to complete this week's assignment involving the math class.